The application for injunctive relief, or in the alternative, to vacate stays of the district court proceedings presented to Justice Alito, and by him referred to the court, is denied. To prevail in an application for a stay or an injunction, an applicant must carry the burden of making a strong showing that it is likely to succeed on the merits, that it will be irreparably injured absent a stay, that the balance of equities favors it, and that a stay is consistent with the public interest. If you have been following the news from the U.S. Supreme Court, you should be aware of the first lines from this opinion, if you actually read the case. But if you only heard about this decision on the news and follow the court like a fan follows a sports team in football or baseball or basketball, rooting for your favorite team, then this esoteric language in the mind of a layman is what has been called a big abortion case. And note that not even one word at the beginning ever said anything about abortion, but rather only a decision on procedural rules, which is generally what is decided in many appellate decisions that, in the news, become a drama of winners and losers in something that the court never really discussed. And while football, baseball, or whatever your favorite sport is, will never be changed forever by a good or bad call by a referee, you can always play another game. When it is a court case being decided by a judge in a courtroom, precedent is created under stare decisis. And Chief Justice John Marshall said it the best near the beginning of the Republic. It is emphatically the province and duty of the judicial department to say what the law is. And those decisions about the law have consequences and repercussions for us all. And which is why you don't need to retain an attorney to understand a sporting event and articulate your feelings, and why they say that only a fool represents himself or herself in a courtroom. So why are you playing lawyer when you hear about a case on the news? Are you not that fool? So let's talk about this case in a matter that it may not be discussed on the news in your echo chamber. Because especially with the latest round of vaccine mandate from the president, it is rather important to understand that it is intriguing that reporters at the Hill, a strong supporter of the president, departed the pack of persons discussing the case as an abortion case, but rather one of procedure, which it is. So for the next few moments, let's examine the procedure, beginning with how the matter was brought into the Supreme Court. There was an application for injunctive relief, temporary restraining order, which is basically an order to cease and desist from doing something. And the appellant also brought in the alternative, an application to vacate stays of the district court proceedings, or basically requesting that if the court cannot order that something to cease and desist, then as a substitute remedy, the appellant was requesting that the trial court be ordered to not proceed until further notice. Cut and dry, plain and simple. And this application was presented to Justice Alito because each district court in the United States has a particular Supreme Court justice assigned to matters that may arise in that jurisdiction. And the appellant in this case had been involved as a party in a legal action that had been commenced in the federal court, and then decided that an issue was so urgent that the intervention of the Supreme Court was required. This happens all the time. Not long ago, a similar case arose involving Justice Amy Coney Barrett, and she had declined consideration of that matter. And people made a big to-do about that. But in this case, Justice Anthony Alito Jr. referred the matter to the full Supreme Court, and that application was denied in a 5-4 decision. 9 justices that the president wants to add more so that he could probably avert some of these problems. And the dissents included Justice Stephen Breyer, Justice Maria Sotomayor, Justice Elena Kagan, and Justice John Glover Roberts Jr. And at the outset, the court states a common rule for injunctive relief that is familiar at least to those in law or any law student, to the extent that most should be able to recite from rote memory, like a childhood vile verse, stating to prevail in an application for a stay or an injunction, an applicant must carry the burden of making a strong showing that it is likely to succeed on the merits, number one, that it will be irreparably injured absent a stay, that the balance of the equities favors it, and that a stay is consistent with the public interest. If you're a law student or an attorney, you say it like a Bible verse. So why do reporters at the Hill say this case raises fundamental questions beyond the abortion issue, touching on the exercise of individual civil rights and the authority of state governments to impose its view over and against the supreme law of the land through legislative sleight of hand? They say the statutory language denying state officials the right to bring a lawsuit against a person under this law is at the heart of this controversy. Insofar, the law expressly denies standing to state government officials of enforcing the law. Texas legislature officials purposefully placed a procedural obstacle to judicial challenges to its constitutionality. Now wait, before it was about the procedure at the court, but now it's about the procedure in the law that's at issue. Take your mind off abortion and look at what the Texas legislature actually did. Recall when Governor Northam first instituted the lockdowns and he told Virginians that he did not want to place anyone in jail, and how he developed a similar enforcement structure for enforcing the facial coverings mandates, and how he even refused, like the president, to directly mandate the COVID-19 vaccines, and would basically delegate this responsibility for enforcement upon the businesses. And inside the literature upon which he relied on for masks, he said that he was going to give you empowerment and efficacy in the pandemic so that you could perform a public good and enforce yourself and encourage others to do so, just like you probably saw many people trying to help you to decide to get the vaccine. But just yesterday, with the new announcement about a directive to the Department of Labor telling Americans, if you want to do business with us, you must get vaccinated. But while the Hill has never described the COVID-19 response as a violation of civil rights, when this procedure was applied to abortion, they stated that it expressly denies standing to state government officials of enforcing the law. Texas legislature purposefully placed a procedural obstacle to judicial challenges to its constitutionality. But back in July, the president went to Facebook and said, hey, we have some problems with these accounts, and we want you to take on the authority to disable accounts and delete posts. The Hill concedes that it must be noted that the Supreme Court did not adjudicate on the constitutionality of SB 8, but rather refused to grant injunctive relief at this stage of the proceedings. And then suddenly shifting their argument, they say that not they, but the justices who dissented had scholastically argued that the case presents novel procedural questions. As, for example, the power of the federal courts to enjoin individuals tasked with enforcing the laws, but not the laws themselves. Just like coronaviruses that had been discovered in animals in 1932 and in humans in 1965, 1966, that may have been novel to you, how novel to an attorney is the idea that the power of the federal courts is to enjoin individuals tasked with enforcing laws, but not the laws themselves? It is actually not very novel at all, and which is why when an attorney wishes to enjoin a government agency or official from performing any action, they request both injunctive and declaratory relief. And the declaratory relief generally takes the form of what is described as a facial or an as-applied challenge against the law or regulation itself. There is nothing at all novel about that idea, unless you are not an attorney. How about this other allegedly novel issue as to whether the court can issue an injunction against state judges asked to decide a lawsuit under Texas law, which was that part of the application where a request had been filed in the alternative to vacate stays of the district court proceedings? Doesn't appellate court have the power to vacate the actions of a lower court? Have you ever heard a judicial decision where, at the end, the court will state reversed and remanded? Have you ever seen a jury verdict nullified? In fact, under the All Writs Act, a litigant has the civil right to present a writ of mandamus to the trial court or even the appellate court to which it is subordinate to compel that court to perform what is described as a ministerial or administrative act, which requires no judgment at all, and that it should have performed in the first place had it followed the law. This is not a case of first impression regarding that well-established jurisprudence, and in fact, during the desegregation of public school facilities, which we all recall, in which it took the County of Arlington 5 years to comply with the orders of the United States Supreme Court to proceed with all deliberate speed, which the Constitution in Article 3, where it states under the separation of powers doctrine that the judicial power of the United States shall be vested, not invested, as they say in Johnson City at WJHL, in one Supreme Court, and in such inferior courts as the Congress may from time to time ordain and establish. And additional federal court action had to be commenced in the County of Arlington, in the Commonwealth of Virginia, to compel them, which had been under Harry Byrd, engaged in what had been described by Reverend Martin Luther King in his famous dream speech on August 28, 1963, which progressives celebrated during the last election right before to remind people about their connection to Dr. King. He described a certain governor down in Arkansas as having lips dripping with words of interposition and nullification. Something that suddenly Rachel Maddow at MSNBC was saying was a good thing. An assertion of states' rights had been telling the federal government that it could not tell them to do what they wanted to do. The argument that became the impetus of the secession and a great civil war, testing whether that nation or any nation so conceived and so dedicated could long endure. Yet according to the president, who is himself an attorney by profession, and who says he went to a black church, in a statement on September 2nd, and who just had yesterday told Americans that when it came to mandating vaccines, it was not about your rights, departs from what even the Hill had described at first as a procedural decision for what had occurred at the Supreme Court, and returns to the issue of abortion, stating, "The Supreme Court's ruling overnight is an unprecedented assault on women's constitutional rights under Roe v. Wade, which has been the law of the land for almost 50 years. By allowing a law to go into effect that empowers private citizens in Texas to sue health care providers, family members supporting a woman exercising her right to choose after 6 weeks, or even a friend who drives her to a hospital or clinic, it unleashes unconstitutional chaos and empowers self-anointed enforcers, vigilantes, to have devastating impacts on the rights of a woman to have an abortion." The president says that complete strangers will now be empowered to inject, like a vaccine, themselves in the most private and personal health decision faced by women. "This law is so extreme," he says, "it does not even allow for exceptions in the case of rape or incest, touching your heartstrings with those rare cases." And he says it not only empowers complete strangers to inject themselves into the most private of decisions made by women, it actually incentivizes them to do so with the prospect of $10,000 if they win their case. "But it's okay for me to give you an award if you get a vaccine or encourage others to do so." Since 1992, a private citizen, any complete stranger, has had the civil right under the Freedom of Access to Clinic Entrances or FACE Act to file suit and be awarded at least $5,000 incentivized for every time upon which a person had blocked their access to an abortion facility. And for some reason, the Federal District Court in Richmond has been reluctant to address whether the authority granted by that same statute to a person attempting to enter a place of worship, especially if blocked online on Facebook by having their account disabled, blocked by strangers, has the same right as a civil remedy in court to a woman seeking an abortion. And they have won every time they have brought that case since 1992. In the city of New York, right now, without a hearing to establish that you are in fact infected and represent a risk to safety, you can be denied entry to a restaurant only because you have not been vaccinated. Even after the CDC has claimed that vaccinated persons can spread COVID-19, especially after events in Cape Cod after the 4th of July, where we were told that super spreader events occurred amongst vaccinated persons. For over a year, without a hearing to determine that you are infected, in fact, you have been compelled to wear a non-medical grade facial covering without a hearing and by strangers. The topic of our current petition for certiorari at the Supreme Court, and not even one study performed to date has established that they are even effective, as has been claimed, at preventing you from becoming infected. You cannot attend University of Virginia, and 99% of students matriculating in the fall have apparently just rolled over and said okay without a determination that they are in fact a threat to anybody else. But the president says that for the majority to do this without a hearing, without the benefit of an opinion from a court below, and without due consideration of the issues, insults the rule of law and the rights of all Americans to seek redress from our courts. But any person seeking a restraining order in a case of domestic violence knows that a temporary restraining order can be issued in an ex parte proceeding. And many court actions, this happens as well, and can even, without a hearing, dismiss an action, apparently, as any pro se litigant knows. And presently before the Supreme Court, we have an action where, with not even one hearing or entry of appearance by the governor or the state attorney general, the case is proceeded through the federal district court up to the Fourth Circuit of Appeals that had affirmed the right of the U.S. District Court for the Eastern District of Virginia in Richmond to dismiss a case without a hearing. In our lockdown case, the city of Alexandria actually said that when you bring up a claim raising your religious liberties, there's not even a justiciable issue. And they just dismissed the case. They did the same thing with the Pride Month proclamation case, where we were trying to seek an injunction. They said there was no justiciable issue. But not on abortion, which is apparently a more favored civil right, but on the authority of the governor to compel a person to wear a facial covering while engaged in devotional worship, it's a different story. Or mandate a vaccine. Or have someone else do it for him. Perhaps things are not about your rights when the governor or the president declares that it is not about your rights. And apparently, now that we have elected a king, that is no longer the rule of the land. These are the same people that did not want to make America great again. And as long as it involves vaccines and facial coverings, it is neither about your body nor about your choice. Live long and prosper, Star Voyagers. This briefing is unclassified. Everyone. My name is Major Mike Webb, and by God, I am running for Auburn Public School Board. Let's keep Mike Webb away from us. Honest. Carry on. Was authorized by Mike Webb.
punk. I could have had a vaccine.